Good morning. Thank you all for coming on such a beautiful day. I'm David Wessel. I'm director of the Hutchins Center on Fiscal and Monetary Policy here at Brookings. Once upon a time, when people talked about fiscal and monetary policy, the phrase financial stability was either not mentioned, or if it was mentioned, it was somebody else's job. But we learned the hard way during the global financial crisis and the Great Recession that global financial stability is a really important public good, and like it or not, the Federal Reserve has some responsibility for at least minimizing the risk of financial instability. I'm very pleased this morning to welcome Neel Kashkari, the new president of the Minneapolis Fed, to talk about this subject. Mr. Kashkari has more experience in this than, say, your ordinary person on the street. As you know, he started as a mechanical engineer, ended up at Goldman Sachs, left Goldman Sachs because he talked his way into a job at the Treasury with Hank Paulson, ended up running the TARP, the Troubled Asset Relief Program, made himself famous by being on TV defending it. Because that wasn't enough fun, he went to PIMCO to start an equity fund there. PIMCO, as you know, is one of those places where you learn how people get together well to make money. After that, he ran for governor of California against Jerry Brown. Jerry Brown won, in case you're wondering, 60-40, but he made quite a name for himself as a Republican candidate who actually cared about people who make less than $3 million a year. Neel is the new president of the Minneapolis Fed, and the Minneapolis Fed has a long tradition of thinking about financial stability and banking. As you'll meet later, Gary Stern, who was the president of the Minneapolis Fed for more than two decades, and in 2004 with Ron Feldman, wrote a book called Too Big to Fail that looked pretty good at the time and looks even better from hindsight. I'm proud to say it was published by the Brookings Press. And I'd also like to welcome Bruce McClory, a former president of the Minneapolis Fed and a former president of Brookings. Neel Kashkari is going to speak for a bit, then I'll be joined up here by Gary Stern and Don Cohn, my colleague and the former vice chair of the Fed. I'm sorry that weather has prevented both Sue Bies and Betsy Duke from getting here. It turns out it was easier to get here from Minneapolis than from Point South. Neel Kashkari.
Thank you, David, for the kind introduction. It is great to be back at the Brookings Institution, and I'd also like to thank the Hutchins Center for hosting us here today. I also want to thank all of you for coming out. You know, we've got some tough weather. Washington's been hit a lot, and I really appreciate you braving the elements for those of you who are here in the room, and our distinguished fellow panelists, Gary Stern, Don Cohn, Chairman Bernanke, and Bruce, you know, our long predecessor as well. Thank you all for being here. I just want to remind everyone that the views I'm expressing today are my own, and I'm not speaking on behalf of the Federal Open Market Committee or the Board of Governors, which sets regulatory and supervision policy on behalf of the Federal Reserve System. Today, I will offer my assessment of the current status and outlook for ending the problem of too big to fail banks. I come at this problem from the perspective of a policymaker who was on the front line responding to the financial crisis in 2008. When Congress moved quickly to pass the Dodd-Frank Act in 2010, I strongly supported the need for financial reform, but I wanted to see the act implemented before I drew firm conclusions about whether or not it solved too big to fail. In the last 6 years, my colleagues across the Federal Reserve System have worked diligently under the reform framework that Congress established and are fully utilizing the available tools under the act to address too big to fail. While significant progress has been made to strengthen the financial system, I believe the act did not go far enough. I believe the biggest banks are still too big to fail and continue to pose an ongoing large risk to our economy. Enough time has passed that we better understand the causes of the crisis, and yet it is still fresh in our memories. Now is the right time for Congress to consider going further than Dodd-Frank with bold, transformational solutions to solve this problem once and for all. The Federal Reserve Bank of Minneapolis is launching a major initiative to develop an actionable plan to end too big to fail, and we will deliver our plan to the public by the end of the year. Ultimately, Congress must decide whether such a transformational restructuring of our financial system is justified in order to mitigate the ongoing risks posed by large banks. Although too-big-to-fail banks were not the sole cause of the recent financial crisis and the Great Recession, there is no question that their presence at the center of our financial system contributed significantly to the magnitude of the crisis and to the extensive damage it inflicted across the economy. Given the scale of job losses, home foreclosures, lost savings, and cost to taxpayers, regulators and Main Street agree with elected leaders that we must solve the too-big-to-fail problem. We know that markets make mistakes. That is unavoidable in an innovative economy. But these mistakes cannot be allowed to endanger the rest of the country. When roughly 1,000 savings and loans failed in the late 1980s, there was no risk of an economic collapse. When the technology bubble burst in 2000, it was very painful for Silicon Valley and for technology investors, but it did not pose a systemic risk to our economy. Large banks must similarly be able to make mistakes, even very big mistakes, without requiring taxpayer bailouts and without triggering widespread economic damage. That must be our goal. Now, since 2008, legislators and regulators have worked hard to address the too-big-to-fail problem. My colleagues in the Federal Reserve System, working closely with other financial regulators, have implemented important tools and regulations that are making the financial system stronger. Regulators have forced large banks to hold more capital and have deeper, more resilient sources of liquidity. Our stress tests check whether the most systemically important institutions can withstand a serious shock to the economy. In some cases, institutions have responded to these higher regulatory requirements by reducing certain activities. Considerable progress has been made, and these are steps in the right direction. But regulators know that despite these best efforts, banks will still sometimes make mistakes and run into trouble. To ensure that banks can fail without requiring massive taxpayer bailouts, regulators are using the living will review process to try to address the hurdles that make large banks so hard to resolve. They are establishing a resolution approach intended to give regulators the ability to restructure large banks without massive spillovers, and they have proposed requiring large banks to issue debt that would help recapitalize the firm if necessary. All of these measures are sensible. Policymakers are committed to seeing these important efforts through. The question is, should we be satisfied with this approach, or should we do more? The lessons I learned during the 2008 financial crisis strongly influenced my assessment of new regulatory measures to address the too-big-to-fail problem. I learned in the crisis that determining which firms are systemically important, which are too big to fail, depends on economic and financial conditions. In a strong, stable economy, the failure of a given bank might not be systemic. The economy and financial firms and markets might be able to withstand a shock from such a failure without much harm to other institutions or to families and businesses. But in a weak economy, with skittish markets, policymakers will be very worried about such a bank failure. After all, that failure might trigger contagion to other banks and cause a widespread downturn. Thus, although the size of an institution, its connections to other institutions, and its importance to the plumbing of the financial system are all relevant in determining whether or not it is too big to fail, there is no simple formula that defines what is systemic. I wish there were. It requires judgment from policymakers to assess conditions at the time. I know this is unsatisfactory to many people, but it is the truth today. Perhaps one day we'll have better tools to make this determination analytically. A second lesson for me from the 2008 crisis is that almost by definition, we will not see the next crisis coming, and it won't look like what we might be expecting. If we or markets recognize an imbalance in the economy, market participants would likely take action to protect themselves. When I first went to Treasury in 2006, Treasury Secretary Henry Paulson directed his staff to work with financial regulators at the Federal Reserve and at the Securities and Exchange Commission to look for what might trigger the next crisis. Based on his experience, we were due for a crisis because markets had been stable for several years. We looked at a number of scenarios, including a large bank, an individual large bank running into trouble, or a hedge fund suffering large losses, among other scenarios. We didn't consider a nationwide housing downturn. We didn't see it. It seems so obvious now. We didn't see it, and we were looking. We must assume that other policymakers in the future won't see future crises coming either. A final lesson from the crisis is that the externalities of large bank failures can be massive. I am not talking about just the fiscal cost of bailouts. Even with the 2008 bailouts, the cost to society from the financial crisis in terms of lost jobs, lost income, and lost wealth were staggering. Many trillions of dollars and devastation for millions of families. Failures of large financial institutions pose massively asymmetric risks to society that policymakers must consider. We had a choice in 2008. Spend taxpayer money to stabilize large banks, or don't, and potentially trigger many trillions of additional costs to society. A very crude analogy is that of a nuclear reactor. The cost to society of letting a reactor melt down is astronomical. Given that cost, governments will do whatever they can to stabilize the reactor before they lose control. Regulatory reforms since the crisis have focused both on making banks safer so they are less likely to fail, and on creating tools to resolve troubled banks by imposing losses on creditors without destabilizing the economy. Based on lessons from the recent crisis, I evaluate these restructuring tools by asking the following questions. Would policymakers responding to a future crisis actually use them? And how likely are they to be effective? To answer these questions, I consider two simplified scenarios. First, an individual large bank runs into trouble while the economy and financial system are otherwise sound and strong. And number two, one or more large banks runs into trouble while there is broader weakness and risks in the global economy. My assessment of these tools under the first scenario, the healthy economy scenario, is that they do have the potential to deal with the failure of an individual large financial institution without requiring a bailout or triggering widespread economic damage. But we don't know that for certain, and the work on these tools is incomplete and slow-moving. For example, the reviews of the largest banks' living wills find that they have significant shortcomings, with the government requiring the banks to try once again to make themselves able to fail without massive fallout. Until this work is complete, which could be years from now, we must acknowledge the largest banks are still too big to fail. And even then, we won't know how effective these tools will be until we've actually used them. Unfortunately, I am far more skeptical that these tools will be useful to policymakers in the second scenario of a stressed economic environment. Given the massive externalities on Main Street of large bank failures in terms of lost jobs, lost income, and lost wealth, no rational policymaker would risk restructuring large firms and imposing large losses on creditors and counterparties using the new tools in a risky environment, let alone a crisis environment like we experienced in 2008. They will be forced to bail out failing institutions, as we were. We were even forced to support large bank mergers, which helped stabilize the immediate crisis, but that we knew would make too big to fail worse in the long term. The risks to the U.S. economy and the American people were simply too great not to do whatever we could to prevent a financial collapse. I believe we need to complete the important work that my colleagues are doing so that, at a minimum, we are as prepared as we can be to deal with an individual large bank failure. But given the enormous cost that would be associated with another financial crisis and the lack of certainty about whether these new tools would be effective in dealing with one, I believe we must seriously consider bolder transformational options. Some other Federal Reserve policymakers have noted the potential benefits of considering more transformational measures. I believe we must begin this work now and give serious consideration to a range of options, including breaking up the large banks into smaller, less connected, less important entities, turning large banks into public utilities by forcing them to hold so much capital they virtually can't fail with regulation akin to that of a nuclear power plant, taxing leverage throughout the financial system to reduce systemic risks wherever they lie. Now, options such as these have been mentioned before, but in my view, policymakers and legislators have not yet seriously considered the need to implement them in the near term. They are transformational, and that can be unsettling. The financial sector has lobbied hard to preserve its current structure and thrown up endless objections to fundamental change. And in the immediate aftermath of the financial crisis, when the Dodd-Frank Act was first passed, the economic outlook was perhaps too uncertain to take truly bold action. But the economy is stronger now, and the time has come to move past parochial interests and solve this problem. The risks of not doing so are simply too great. Many of the arguments against adoption of more transformational solution to the problem of too big to fail are that the societal benefits of such financial giants somehow justify the exposure to another financial crisis. I find such arguments unpersuasive. Finance lobbyists argue that multinational corporations do business in many countries and therefore need global banks. But these same corporations manage thousands of suppliers all around the world. Can't they manage a few more banking relationships? Many argue that large banks benefit society by creating economies of scope and scale. No doubt this is true. But cost-benefit analysis requires understanding costs, too. I don't see the benefits of scale of large banks outweighing the massive externalities of a widespread economic collapse. Some argue that if we limited U.S. banks in size or scope, they would be at a disadvantage relative to banks in other countries with looser regulations. If other countries want to take extreme risks with their financial systems, we can't stop them. But the United States should do what is right for our economy and establish one set of rules for those who want to do business here. Given the complexity of this issue, any bold plan will be imperfect, and there will be unanswered questions that skeptical experts can point to as a reason for inaction. How can we precisely define which firms are systemic and dangerous and need to change? How can our plan adapt and endure as the financial system evolves over decades? What if strictly regulating some firms just pushes risk onto other less regulated firms? And how will these new rules impact families and businesses' abilities to make important investments? And what will that mean for employment and economic growth? Experts also correctly point out that there's always the possibility that an economic shock could hit us in the future that is so large or so different from anything we have considered that it overwhelms all of our efforts. In that scenario, only the balance sheet of the federal government would be strong enough to stabilize the financial system as was required in 2008. These are all important considerations, and there are many more. We must work to address them. But if we are serious about solving too big to fail, we cannot let them paralyze us. Any plan that we come up with will be imperfect. Those potential shortcomings must be weighed against the actual risks and actual costs that we know exist today. Perfect cannot be the standard that we must meet before we act. Better and safer are reasons enough to act. Otherwise, we will be left on the default path of incrementalism and the risk that we will someday face another crisis without having done all we could to protect our economy and the American people. As David said, the Federal Reserve Bank of Minneapolis has been at the forefront of understanding the risks and challenges posed by large banks and moral hazard for a long time. Our work on these topics goes back literally to the 1970s, with specific work on too big to fail beginning in the 1990s. As David noted, one of my colleague Ron Feldman, who's here today, and one of my predecessors, Gary Stern, both authored the original book on this topic, Too Big to Fail, arguing in 2004, 3 years before the crisis, they argued that policymakers would not stick to their no bailout pledges. They were right. Building on this important work and work done since the crisis, the Federal Reserve Bank of Minneapolis is launching a major initiative to consider transformational options and to develop an actionable plan to end too big to fail. Starting in the spring, we will hold a series of policy symposiums to explore various options from expert researchers around the country. We will also invite leaders from policy and regulatory institutions, and yes, the financial sector, to offer their views and to test one another's assumptions. We will consider the likely benefits, costs, risks, and implementation challenges of these options. And we will invite the media to these symposiums and live stream them so that the public can follow along and learn along with us. Following the symposiums, we will publish a series of policy briefs summarizing our key takeaways on each issue so that all can provide feedback, and that feedback can begin now. We've established a website where anyone can share with us their ideas for solving too big to fail. If you are a researcher, if you work in the financial sector, if you just have a good idea for solving too big to fail, wherever you are, share it with us at minneapolisfed.org. We will use all of this work to inform our plan to end too big to fail, which we will release by year end for legislators, policymakers, and the public to consider. Congress created the Federal Reserve System to help prevent financial crises from inflicting widespread damage to the U.S. economy. Doing everything we can to address the systemic risks posed by large banks will be an important step to fulfilling that mission. 7 years after the crisis, I believe it is now time to move forward and end too big to fail. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you very much, Neil Kashkari. You certainly, starting your tenure as president of the Minneapolis Fed by giving us something to think about, it'll take you a long time to learn how to give a speech as a Fed president where no one understands what you're saying. So I'm glad we got you before they trained you. I want to start, Neil, by asking you a question, then turn to Gary and to Don. The Dodd-Frank Act begins to promote the financial stability of the United States by approving accountability and transparency in the financial system, to end too big to fail, to protect the American taxpayer by ending bailouts, to protect consumers from abusive financial practices, and for other purposes. And your argument basically is we did not go far enough, correct?
That's correct. Okay. I think a lot of Dodd-Frank has done good, and the financial system is stronger today, but I do not think we've gone far enough to end too big to fail.
Okay, so Eric Rosengren of the Boston Fed gave a speech the other day in which he made two points. He said, one, we have reduced the probability of failure, and two, we have reduced the cost of failure by forcing the banks to have more capital and have more debt that can be bailed in before the taxpayers are. Do you disagree with those assertions?
I agree with the first assertion that we've reduced the chances of large banks running into trouble. But when I think about the cost of failure, it's not simply the cost of the bailout. It's the economic damage that's inflicted across society. And so, you know, think about an analogy. I use the nuclear reactor. Think about the Fukushima disaster. You know, they built a wall so high to try to prevent a tsunami from flooding. Well, the question is not, is the wall high enough? The second question is, how devastating is it to society if the reactor floods nonetheless? And I don't think the second point that we have dealt with adequately.
Okay. Don? What do you think? You agree with them or not?
No. So I think I certainly share Neil's objective of this ending too big to fail, that is allowing any large financial institution to fail with minimal damage on the financial system and on the economy. Absolutely have to do that. That's part of a market system. If you're playing in the market system, you got to be ready not only to earn huge profits, but to fail. And knowing that, your shareholders and creditors have to be ready to lose their money. Now, I guess my question, so we share a goal. You start from the premise, as you just answered David's question, that we haven't done enough. And I guess I'm not sure. So it's possible, but I'd like to hear more of your arguments about why the authorities won't use the new tools they were given. I mean, one of the lessons was one reason that we had to intervene the way we did, and I say we because Neil and I were on basically the same team trying to save the system, was because we didn't have enough tools. The system was too fragile. We've done a lot about that, and we didn't have enough tools. Now, you have the resolution regime, Title II of Dodd-Frank. So you apparently don't think that's going to work, and you don't think the authorities will use it. So the Congress has attempted to certainly wall off the things that the authorities did to save the big banks before. I don't know why those won't work. I assume the authorities would have to go back to Congress for another TARP. I think it'll be several generations before that's possible. So this thing better work, and I think it has. So I think the authorities will use the new resolution, or I'd like to be convinced about how they could get around it. And then I think the new resolution regime, once it's fully in place, probably will work. So the probably is big right there, but I think there's a lot of bailing in the certain creditors, putting them at risk, using that capital to capitalize the operating subs, the systemically important parts, restarting the thing. I'd like to hear why you think that's not going to be sufficient in the next crisis for if there's more than one
right.
institution threatened at the same time. I don't know. I mean, there's a lot of stuff being done, but I think it stands a good chance. And I think you have to, before you say, let's break up the big banks, let's use government to intervene in the private sector in a way that's pretty pretty major, that is taking a private entity and breaking it into different pieces, I think you have to convince me that what's been put in place won't work.
Okay. Gary, do you want to comment, and then we'll let
Yes. I think I largely agree with Don. I think the key in the current legislation to effectively dealing with too big to fail is the living will process. And frankly, I'm comforted by the fact that none of those proposals have been approved yet, because I think they're very difficult to do well. And if they had been approved, I'd be suspicious that they really weren't of adequate quality and wouldn't be effective. But I think it's a big mistake to dismiss that or to underrate the potential in living wills. First of all, they're mandated by Congress, and the regulators have to approve them once they're acceptable. It doesn't require any additional legislation. It doesn't require getting into political battles about who ought to do what to whom. It's in place. And if they're done well, then they're designed to limit spillovers from a problem at one or more major financial institutions, so that the contagion effects, the effects on the overall economy, are manageable. That's what they're designed to do. And therefore, you don't need the government to intervene to protect uninsured creditors or others. Now, the jury is out. It's not obvious that this is going to, that the proposals, once they're in place, will be adequate. But I don't think there's any reason to start with the presumption that they won't be. After all, the regulators are on the hook to get this right. I think that's, you know, absolutely critical. I think there's a lot of promise there. I think the jury is out. But if it's put in place appropriately, and if it's communicated to the public appropriately, and in particular to uninsured creditors and shareholders appropriately, then you should get different pricing in the marketplace of risk-taking, better pricing, and sounder institutions going forward, simply because you have the credible plan in place. So frankly, I think there's a lot of potential there, and if I were still playing in the policy game, that's where I would start, and that's where I would put my emphasis.
So, Neil, you don't think the jury's out, or at least you know what the jury's verdict is. What makes you so sure that the system won't work as Title II of Dodd-Frank and as the living will suggest?
Well, it comes back to what contagion is. So imagine you're in a stressed economic environment, and several big banks are under stress at the same time, and you are a creditor of one of those banks. So that bank owes you money. You're a bondholder. And another bank that looks just like your bank, all of a sudden their debt was converted to equity. Their bondholders are not happy in that environment to not have debt, to now have equity of the bank. The last thing they want in that environment is the equity of that bank right now. They want their money back. So if you're a bondholder of another institution that looks a lot like that first institution, what are you going to do? Get out, if at all possible. And so the contagion risk is the thing that was so, and Don, you know this as well as I do, was so devilishly hard to deal with during the last crisis. And I'm not suggesting that we're going to come up with a plan that's going to solve every economic scenario, every shock, no matter how big. But look at the environment that we're in today. We're in a global economic environment where there's some stress, there's increased volatility. Some bank shares, especially in Europe, have come under trouble. I mean, Don, remember when you were there? Do you really think in 2008, if you had the ability, if the Federal Reserve had the ability to say, we're just going to haircut these bondholders from one bank, you would have pulled the trigger? I don't think so.
I think if the system had been put in place a number of years before and bonds had been issued with the explicit promise that they would be haircut under these circumstances, I think we certainly would have tried it first. And then those bonds become equity, so the rest of the organization is much safer. The runs were on overnight funds. And bailing in these long-term creditors protect the short-term creditors. Sure. And that's where the danger was. So I think if there's ways of doing it, and I think the market is beginning to believe this. Look at what's happened to the CoCos in Europe. And the prices of those and subordinated.
The CoCos are these contingent bonds that
become equity when capital drops to a certain level. And the turmoil that Neil is referencing in banking markets over the last couple weeks, the CDS, the risk premiums on bank bonds, and the prices of these convertible bonds have really been affected. So it feels like the market believes the authorities will at least use some of this creditors to increase the equity of the banks. Now, I think, as you said in your speech, we're not all the way there. The living will process needs to work out. The total loss absorbing capital, how much of this credit should be out there that can be converted? Is it high enough to protect the taxpayers? Are there systems in place at the FDIC, the Bank of England, the European Central Bank to wind down these institutions, put them in receivership in a safe kind of way? Those are still works in progress.
Let me ask you a follow-up, though, Don. So I like this conceptual concept of the TLAC, the loss-absorbing capital, the bonds that convert to equity with the explicit intention of recapitalizing the firm. Why be cute about it? Why not just raise capital requirements? Why not just make it equity so that there's no confusion? Because I look back in 2008, these big banks also issued SIVs. Remember the structured investment vehicles? They had no legal obligation to bail out their SIVs. They ended up having a reputational obligation to bail out the SIVs. So the legal framework became irrelevant. It just became what their customers expected. How do we deal with that?
Bugar, do you think even more capital on the big banks is a good idea?
I don't think it's necessarily a bad idea, but I don't think by itself...
Not exactly a ringing endorsement.
I guess I don't find it by itself to be obviously sufficient, or let me put it this way. It doesn't take advantage, it seems to me, of other improvements we can make. And I wouldn't put all my eggs in just one basket. And so I think there are a number of things that can be done. We've already talked about some of them. Another thing that we haven't talked about, and I'm sure this is going to sound mundane and maybe inside baseball to some people, but in my experience, senior bankers are willing to push back and or ignore regulatory pressure. They're much less likely to do so when they're getting it from their boards of directors. And I think that's an avenue that has been underutilized to date. And I think there's some obvious things that can and should be done there. In some cases, they have been, but not in all and perhaps not in many. For example, you should have an independent chairman. That is, the CEO of the institution should not also be chair of the board of directors. You should have a fair number of independent directors. You should probably have term limits for directors so that they don't get captured by management, et cetera, et cetera. This is all corporate governance stuff, but it's things that, in my judgment, ought to be done. Because it has the potential to improve the situation at relatively low cost. So I would go down that path as well. Another path in Neil's remarks, he talked about parochial interests. Parochial interests are obvious in a lot of places. One of which is turf battles among the regulators. And Paul Volcker has been working on this issue off and on for decades. I'm tempted to say, I'm going to exaggerate the situation a little bit because I don't quite mean it, but our current regulatory structure with, you know, the Fed and the OCC and the FDIC and the SEC and the CFTC, and I could go on and on, it's inefficient, it's ineffective, that's not fair, it's not as effective as it could be, and it's indefensible. And why don't we fix that? Well, I mean, we all can gin up three or four reasons of why we don't fix that. And will it solve too big to fail? No. Will it help lead to a better regulated and supervised financial system? Yes. Does it illustrate parochial issues and the difficulty in dealing with them? Yes.
Neil, how do we know that the problem is solved? What indicators would tell you we've pretty much gone far enough to deal with the too big to fail problem?
Well, one way, and this is obviously a very hard thing to know for sure, and again, I want to reemphasize that we can never eliminate all risk.
Right. Right?
There's always the risk that a shock comes that's so large that...
Right, but you're saying we haven't eliminated enough.
We haven't listened up. You know, I was reading up, it's funny, as I was preparing for this, I actually think this nuclear reactor analogy is a decent one. And I was reading up on...
I'm sure the banks really appreciate your frequent use of them.
I'm sure they appreciate this whole discussion. But there's... The reports on the Fukushima disaster said, you know what, they should have done more homework. Actually, there has been a tidal wave this large in the last 1,000 years. That's a report I just read on, there has been a tidal wave that large, evidence of one, in the last 1,000 years. Now, I'm not saying we have to prepare for a shock that comes one every 1,000 years, but we just had a big shock. We had one 80 years ago in the Great Depression. Those are two big shocks. Should we build a financial system that's strong enough to hit a shock that we are pretty sure is going to hit us once every 100 years? That's a pretty ambitious goal, but I'd like to at least go for it. Even if we can't get there, let's at least try.
So how will we know? I mean, we've seen, for instance, the rating agencies, for whatever value they have, are beginning to believe that the governments will not bail out the banks. We're doing stress tests. Is it that if we make the stress test scenario more severe, that we'll be more confident that we're there? How will you know when we have gone far enough?
You know, I wish I had a precise answer. You know, this is the nature of risk. We're all, it's like another analogy, which I'm sure the banks are going to love, is think about airport security. We're always evolving airport security over the last terrorist threat. So we all take our shoes off when we go through the x-ray machine, right? Does it make us any safer because we take our shoes off? No, because the next attack is going to look different than the prior attacks. And so it requires judgment, and I'm just sharing with you that based on my experience in 08, looking at the types of things that we dealt with, I don't feel like we've gone nearly enough. You know, another analogy, remember Norman Schwarzkopf, the general who ran the first Gulf War? I saw this interview with him when he said, preparing for war is like planning an orchestra. You have all the instruments finely tuned, everyone is practiced, everyone's rehearsed, everyone knows their part. The curtain goes up and he's conducting the orchestra, and a madman jumps up and starts chasing around the stage with a machete. That's what he said war was like. And so all of these things that we're putting in place right now are eminently sensible. They are steps in the right direction. But what happens when the shock hits us that is unlike anything that we've thought of? Are we at least, we should at least be honest with the American people and say, hey, this could happen again. We're doing things that we're doing sensible measures in the right direction, but we want to be honest with you that this could happen again.
Well, you know, we've all been expressing, or Don and I have been expressing reservations about what Neil has proposed. But let me say, I mean, I think what he's got here is thought-provoking and provocative and worth consideration. And let me also add that, you know, if this effort going forward to come up with something before the end of the year is effective, you know, at least it provides a sense of urgency to dealing with the issue. And, you know, one of the things we're... What, 6 years past Dodd-Frank, it doesn't strike me as entirely acceptable that we're still working on the details of all of this. I mean, I know what the reasons are, I know what the stated reasons are, but if there was a real sense of urgency here, I think we'd be further along.
I should remind people, we'll have some questions in a bit, and if you use the hashtag on the Fed, one of Neil's colleagues in the Minneapolis Fed is monitoring Twitter, hashtag Fed Finance, and if there are questions from that way, we'll get them through that route. Two questions. Neil, so Congress said it doesn't want more bailouts. Congress has limited the ability of the Federal Reserve to do what it did in 2008. It has given the FDIC, for better or worse, powers, and the FDIC is developing these powers. Are you saying that in a crunch, the Fed lawyers and the Treasury lawyers are so good, they'll find a way to evade the rules that Congress set up, which is a possibility? Or are you suggesting that we'll be once again in the middle of the night, the chair of the Fed, whoever it is, going to Congress on bended knee and said, please, I need TARP 2.0?
I think it'll depend on the situation. But first of all, the idea, I know many of my Fed colleagues have said this, the idea, we all hate forest fires, so let's take the hoses away from the firefighters. That's not the solution to ending forest fires. The tools that we utilized in 08, both at Treasury and at the Fed, and ultimately with the TARP Authority, were crucial to stabilizing the U.S. economy, absolutely crucial. So that's not the right solution. The right solution is to take action to make sure that the system is stronger and to take the bold action now in advance. And so, you know, I think when I ran for office, I used to joke that the first thing I was going to do as governor is ban traffic. It's easy to just make a declaration that we've banned this. There can be no bailouts. There can be no traffic. Well, is that actually how the world works? And in the reality of we're living in today, we need to be honest with one another about the risk that we still face.
And do we have anything to learn from how other countries are handling the situation, the Swiss, the British, and so forth?
Well, I'd be interested in Don's views because, you know, Don's obviously involved in the UK. My assessment is that they seem more comfortable having these major risks in their financial systems and in their economies. I mean, their banking sector, in many cases, as a percentage of GDP, are larger than our banking sector as a percentage of GDP. And so I feel like we're actually further along in some cases than they are. But I'd love to hear Don's perspective on that.
The Swiss have added a lot of, have required much more capital from their very big banks, which are much bigger relative to their economies than ours. The British, after they got done nationalizing all the banks, have talked about restricting what banks can do, right?
Well, what we in the UK have done is we've...
Don is on the Financial Policy Committee of the Bank of England because the British think you can learn something from foreigners, which does not seem to be an American tradition, at least not since the Revolution.
In the UK, we have increased capital requirements quite considerably, including in the process of increasing them on the globally systemic, globally important banking institutions. I would say, just a little sidebar, if anything, the fact that the banks are a much bigger proportion of GDP in the UK and the US makes the UK more intent on dealing with this. The second thing that's happened is ring fencing. So they've said, the Independent Commission on Banking, which was convened by the Parliament, I guess 4 or 5 years ago after the crisis, said one way of dealing with this too big to fail issue is let's take the parts of the bank that are really systemically important, the ones that take deposits and make loans to consumers and small businesses, payments run through. Let's ring fence them. Let's take them apart, make them separate institutions within a bank holding company and hold them to higher capital requirements. And that's in the process of being implemented. I would note that that's kind of like the U.S. system. So we have bank holding companies, we have depositories that are separated from the investment banks, and the Federal Reserve Board has put higher leverage requirements on the depositories than on the holding company. So there are considerable similarities. I think the other thing the British are doing is they're taking this resolution thing very seriously. And the living wills, but also we on the Financial Policy Committee are considering how much of this total loss-absorbing capital is required. We are trying to run cost-benefit analysis about, to your point, Neil, how much equity, how much debt. And we came out with a number for equity. We thought balance the cost of benefits there, and then we're going to put the debt on top of that. So basically the British are doing the same things that are happening here, but I would say that, if anything, they're more concerned about this than maybe the U.S. Should be, given how big that banking sector is.
You know, you correctly observe that the cost of another financial crisis is enormous. And so, therefore, the benefit to avoiding one has to be pretty big. But one hears quite a bit these days that one reason the U.S. economy isn't doing better is because we have made the banks too risk-averse, that the proliferation of bank regulatory agencies that Carrie Stern only partially listed, we could have added the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, and then whatever these guys don't do, the FSOC, the Financial Stability Oversight Council wants to do, is hurting us on economic growth. Do you take that, those warnings seriously, or you just think they're outweighed by the risk of another crisis?
No, I do take them seriously, and I'm very sensitive to the fact, especially that small banks and community banks are, though it's not the intention of regulators, they're being caught up in the regulatory net that's focused on the largest banks. And so if we took more aggressive action to make the large banks safer, then perhaps we could relieve some of the burden across the system and maybe free up some of the community banks from some of the regulation so that it's easier for them to lend to families and to small businesses. So I take that seriously, and I think that we can address that as part of the solution that I'm hoping we can come up with.
I'd like to pick up a point that Gary made and then come back to the British U.S. thing. So Gary's point about the fragmentation, balkanization of the regulatory structure in the U.S., I used to think that we kind of lived with it and there were people worked together, but I don't anymore. So I think it's a very serious problem. One reason it's taken so long for the Dodd-Frank rules to be put in place is it requires cooperation among all these agencies, and they each have a slightly different perspective. And then finally, I think the organization, one big way in which the UK is organized differently from the US, and I should have said this right away, is the Financial Policy Committee. So there is a committee with a little bit like FSOC, but doesn't have 10 agencies sitting around the table, focused entirely on the systemic risk and the resilience of the UK financial system to a tidal wave, to a serious tail event. And we've been given the tools, including in residential real estate, which aren't really here in the US, and capital, liquidity, to do this. Now, whether we'll be successful over time, only time will tell and events will tell. But I do think the UK is much better organized to keep the system safer than the US with all these warring agencies, many of which don't have a explicit financial stability mandate.
Gary, do you take seriously the claims of the banks and others that all this regulation and the cacophony from the regulators is hurting the economy?
Only partially at best, for a couple of reasons. I agree with Neil that it doesn't make a lot of sense to me to include community banks, in fact, banks that clearly are not systemically important, in the same umbrella. I mean, that's a waste of resources in lots of different ways. And we're certainly smart enough to fix that. But you know, we see after every recession a reaction from the regulators, which is to tighten things in the financial services industry, and then that's always followed by concerns and maybe in some cases reality of well, now credit's not available even to quality borrowers, et cetera, et cetera, and then people get over it and life goes on. And we've seen that before. I think we're seeing that again. I think the best way, and these are not mutually exclusive, but I think the best way to understand what's happened to the U.S. economy in the wake of the financial crisis is Reinhard Rogoff. I think, you know, they wrote, for those of you who aren't familiar with their book, I think it's called This Time is Different, that's tongue-in-cheek, and they wrote a book, the message of which is, and they've done extensive historical research across countries, across time periods, et cetera, the message of the book is economic recoveries following a serious financial crisis turn out to be frustrating, disappointing, substandard, et cetera, not wholly independent of what policymakers do, but largely independent, and apparently it's the hangover of the financial crisis. So if I were trying to understand the performance of the U.S. economy, in the last 6-7 years, that's where I'd start.
Now, let me ask you one final question before we turn to the audience, and that's about the politics of making a speech like this now. I mean, there are lines in your speech that I can imagine Bernie Sanders or Elizabeth Warren saying. It's not what one expects from a Goldman Sachs Republican who was responsible for ripping off the taxpayers during TARP.
We made a profit. The taxpayers made a profit. Yeah. Just point that out.
So I'm just curious, what's going through your mind? What led you to decide that a couple months into the job that you wanted to start playing in this sandbox and be as provocative as you
Well, were? You know, I was interested in this, in joining the Minneapolis Fed, because I wanted to take on the biggest economic and financial challenges we have as a country. And I didn't know what those challenges would be. And when I got to the bank, I found a lot of expertise on too big to fail, on large banks and bank regulation. And as I started talking to my expert colleagues about my ideas, some of the concerns that I had, you know, I first wrote about this, I gave a speech at the Chicago Fed in 2011, where I said, right after Dodd-Frank was passed, I said, here are some of my concerns, let's not declare victory. We've got more to learn, we've got more work to do. So those ideas were still in my head, and as I got into the bank, I started talking to the experts and testing some of my ideas, some of my assumptions, I realized, wow, there are still big risks here. And if I'm not willing to, you know, the Fed's core mission is financial stability. That's one of the Fed's missions. If I'm not willing to stand up and share my concerns, then I wouldn't be doing my job. And so that's what's motivating it. It's funny, I actually wrote the first draft of this, at least a concept for it, in December before I even had started at the bank, and I wanted to get my colleagues' reaction to it. And then here we are.
Good. Okay, let's take some questions. We have mics going around, and I'd like people to stand up if they have a question. When they ask it, remember it's a question, tell us who you are. Why don't we start over here?
Hi, thank you very much. Eduardo Pascual, I'm from Georgia University. I would like to ask you regarding the relation between debt and deflation. Like a year ago, McKinsey published a very interesting piece of research showing how the global debt has been increasing from 150 trillion to up to 200 trillion. I would like to ask you if regarding a new environment where we are seeing deflation in many OECD countries, do you think that this more complicated possibility of honoring this debt for the debtors in real terms is going to be a challenge for the financial sector security?
So just to make sure I understand, you're asking if we're in a period of very low inflation or falling prices, deflation, doesn't that make the debt problem even worse?
Exactly.
Well, there's no question if we were in a situation of deflation that would, part of the problem with deflation, why it's so painful for economies, is that if exactly that, it makes the debt overhang so much worse because the debt grows in real terms. And so that's why I think central banks all around the world are absolutely committed to achieving their inflation targets. In the Fed's case, it's the 2% target that we have established.
Ben Bernanke?
So all you're calling for is more study. Academics can always be in favor of that, right? let me make an argument on your side and see if you agree with it. There's a lot of folks, even on the FOMC, who think that interest rates ought to be managed in part to avoid financial instability, you know, interest rates too low for too long and those sorts of things. And it strikes me that the decision to move monetary policy in ways which are inconsistent with the near-term employment and inflation mandates is actually potentially a very big cost that people are undertaking because they're worried about the implications of debt buildup and so on. Would you take that? Would you agree with that? Would you agree that that's an argument in your side that, you know, structural change is better potentially than using monetary policy to try to make financial stability goals?
I think absolutely I agree with that. I think before I joined the Fed, some of my now colleagues on the FOMC ran, some of the Reserve Bank presidents ran a scenario, a dry run of imagine if there was a bubble that they saw coming, what tools could they use? And they found themselves very limited in having to go with a monetary policy tool potentially to try to deflate that bubble, which is a very difficult thing to do because you can't target it. And so I think if we can make the financial system stronger on its own, in some sense, you're relieving some of the burdens on the monetary policy process so they can really just focus on the dual mandate. Otherwise, some people argue we have too many mandates, right? A dual mandate instead of just an inflation mandate. Well, now we have a dual mandate and a financial stability mandate. And as you said, Chairman Bernanke, there are times when those things are in conflict with one another. So I do agree with that.
Donna, Gary, do you want to?
Well, that's exactly why one reason I worry that the U.S. isn't as well organized for so-called macroprudential policies that could lean against using regulation and supervision and rules, lean against buildups of imbalances in the financial system, because I think it would put more pressure. I'd prefer to do that before monetary policy. So I think another response to your concerns, Ben, would be to do something about the regulatory system, build up the macroprudential capabilities in the U.S. and organize them better.
Well, for better or for worse, I don't necessarily agree with that, and I'm on record of one of the last things I wrote when I was still at the Minneapolis Fed was trying to raise the issue of should you use monetary policy to deflate asset price bubbles, recognizing, of course, that identifying a bubble is not the easiest thing in the world. And I suspect Don's quite uncomfortable with that, and maybe Neil is, and I gather Ben is. But it's a cost-benefit thing. It's the same thing that Neil was talking about earlier. I mean, given the costs of the financial crisis and looking back at it, it seems to me it was worth asking the question, should monetary policy have been more restrictive, say higher nominal interest rates or however you want to define it, prior to the crisis, because the cost of the crisis turned out to be so great? And I don't think you can just dismiss that. There may be better ways of addressing it, although, frankly, I have yet to hear a clear definition of what macroprudential regulation is, much less how effective it might be. But I don't think you can just dismiss it, because the cost of its cost-benefit and the cost of the last financial crisis were
I think the
enormous.
Argument is not that it should be dismissed, but it's not a good place to be if that's our first option, because it would involve raising interest rates so much in order to burst a bubble, that we would rather have some other tools to do it. You're suggesting macroprudential is a nice way to describe something we don't understand.
Yes, and I'm also suggesting that we don't know how much it would take to raise interest rates. You know, if one of my former colleagues was sitting here, a couple of my former colleagues were sitting here, I don't want to put words in their mouth, so I won't identify them, but I think they would say, well, you know, a surprise increase in interest rates would have a big effect, surprise increase. Now that, you know, the Fed has worked very hard at transparency and at helping market participants understand what's coming and, if possible, when it's coming and so forth. But that's not the only view of policy. So, you know, let's have the cards on the table.
Okay. I think there's a question in the back there.
Thank you, sir. I really like the metaphors that you used, nuclear reactor, fire hoses, and everything else. But I had to ask a question about where we still are since 2008. I think, do you believe that the economy is still on life support because we're still having to keep the interest rates low and, in fact, we're still having to do the money being pumped into the system? Do you believe that is still the case or do you think that it's going to be changing soon?
Okay, let's take another one. Gentleman over here. Right, yeah.
So it took 3 years or 4 years for real estate prices to drop by a third because there was so much time involved in that. We were able to build paper on paper, and it created a huge worldwide economic crisis. The banks proved that they could do it again in 6 months, where they were lending aggressively to the oil patch at $100 a barrel. 6 months later, oil dropped 75%. But because they didn't have enough time to build that into a huge worldwide thing where there was paper built on paper and so on, it seems like the crisis is not quite the equivalent. But my question is, about the only thing we've seen out of Congress is that they took the money, the slush fund money that the Fed had that helped solve and stabilize the last time around, they took the money to use for the highway bill instead. And I'm wondering, how important do you think losing that emergency tool may prove to be?
Okay, we'll take one more gentleman here.
I speak as a layman. On the street, we still believe the big banks will be bailed out. And
Dodd-Frank. Neil.
Yeah, Dodd-Frank, Dodd-Frank is still fighting the last war.
Okay, two questions and a comment. Let's start with the, Don, maybe you can help clarify this. Does the Fed have the financial capacity to deal with a crisis if one occurs? despite what Congress did on the highway bill?
Yes. So I think I wouldn't characterize the Fed's capital as a slush fund. That's an entry on a balance sheet. The capital itself didn't really play a role in any of the things that the Fed did. Now, I don't think Congress should be just taking that capital without a careful consideration of what the whole structure of the Federal Reserve should be and how it should be capitalized, et cetera. So I don't agree that taking that was a great idea, a good way to finance highways. There are better ways to do that. But I don't think that by itself doesn't affect the Fed's ability to do other things, make loans in particular, in a crisis. And I think Congress has constrained that, particularly loans to non-banking institutions, has to get the permission of the Secretary of the Treasury. There's a lot of emphasis on security, and there's a lot of transparency that I worry about some of the restrictions that are already on the Fed's ability to take loans, but it has absolutely nothing to do with the highway bill.
Anil, do you think it's correct to characterize the U.S. economy as still on life support and demanding lots of support from the Fed?
No, I think we've come a long way since the depths of the crisis in 08 and 09, and the economy is fundamentally stronger. And if you look at the FOMC statement in January, I've been to one FOMC meeting, that was my first.
Did you say anything?
I did. Can you imagine me being quiet?
No.
The committee's judgment is that the economic outlook is for moderate economic growth. And if the reality ends up like the outlook, then I think we're going to be heading in a better direction.
Okay. Over here.
Thank you very much. Larry Checo with Accountability Central. A lot of interesting points here. But I'm going to go one step further. I think the regulatory agencies failed us miserably in this last crisis. And do you believe that they've been rehabilitated enough to, you know, get us through another one? But my real question is, are we over-engineering these regulations? It seemed to me that maybe people should have looked up beyond their computer models and actually seen what was happening going on the ground. Prices of housing was going up immensely, wages are flat, terrible mortgage rates were being, nobody questioning any of that. So maybe we have to inject more common sense than regulation into this equation. Thank you.
The gentleman behind you.
Thank you, Hiroshoka, the Japanese Embassy, and I have a question to Neil. You said that transformational policy options are necessary, which includes also breaking up larger banks. But I think Dodd-Frank Act already gives regulator authorities to break up larger banks in case their living wills are insufficient. But do you think further legislative authorities are necessary for regulators? And could you explain about what are kind of authorities or legislative measures are necessary?
Okay, so just so I make sure I got it, you're saying that the regulators already have some authority to break up the big banks. Is he suggesting that they use that authority, or is he suggesting they need new legislative powers? Do you want to take those two?
Sure. My view is to do anything transformational system-wide, we would need new legislation. I agree that the authorities do have the ability within the living will framework, the FDIC and the Fed working together to target an individual institution. But my read of Dodd-Frank, and as I watched the debate, I don't think the intention of Congress was that Dodd-Frank was meant to be a tool for transformation of the financial sector. I think a transformational solution is something that it is absolutely appropriate and necessary for Congress to weigh in on and take an active role in deciding what that transformation looks like, rather than using one little tool over here and trying to use that across the whole system.
Okay, so I think we have some questions from Twitter that Paul Wallace is going to read.
Thanks, David. A theme that's being talked about is the difference in treatment between the large banks and the small banks, and a question that isn't there still contagion risk among small banks if a number, you know, if many of them are involved, you know, how do those risks weigh against the risks faced by the large banks?
So what I mentioned in my speech was when you look at the savings and loan crisis, you had 1,000 small banks fail. And that was devastating for those banks and for their communities, and that's not a good thing. I'm not saying we should celebrate that. But there was no broader risk of economic contagion or economic collapse. And so to me, if we can get our financial system in a situation where we can take on major shocks without requiring taxpayer bailouts and without triggering a widespread downturn, that should be our goal.
But isn't there was a recession.
Understood.
Right, after the thrift. I mean, it was more than the thrifts, right? So some of the banks got in trouble. But there was a recession, and the recession was prolonged, and the recovery was damped by the credit restrictions right. that occurred after that. So I guess I'm not, if you took a big bank that was systemically important and broke it up into 8 smaller banks that each had the same balance sheet,
and the same strategy.
The same strategy. You wouldn't be doing anything, right?
Agreed. If you break it up and there's no change in their business models and there's no change in behavior, but when you have corporate governance that Gary talked about with different CEOs and different boards of directors and their different geographies, you know, that's probably not the situation that we're going to end up in. And by the way, I'm not saying that breaking up the banks is necessarily the right solution. It's one of the solutions. If you took all the big banks and you stuffed 25% capital in them, they're going to be a heck of a lot stronger than they are today and be able to take a much bigger wave.
Yeah, I'm not persuaded that even a large number of community banks would pose a systemic risk to the financial system or the economy. Community bankers sometimes like to invoke that for level playing field considerations, et cetera, but I don't find it convincing.
There's a woman in the brown. Could you stand up so the mic can find you? And then there's a gentleman on the aisle in the orange shirt.
Full disclosure, I was one of those regulators a long time ago. I was not in the most recent crisis, but I was certainly involved in the New England commercial real estate crisis. I think one of the things...
Which regulator did you work for?
I was with the OCC. I think one of the things that needs to be addressed, and we're kind of circling around it, is banks fail for two reasons. They fail for illiquidity, and they fail for lack of capital. Of course, capital is assets minus liabilities. In terms of systemic risk, when you have assets that are concentrated, you have systemic risk, whether that's across a variety of small institutions or concentrated amongst large institutions. I think one of the things that you haven't addressed, you mentioned it and you kind of slid through it, was the issue of, well, if we do it in the United States, we don't really have to look globally. But I think our economy has changed. We are in a much more fluid, much more global economy than ever before. And I wonder what would be the implications if we make regulations, if we look and say, well, we'll just make them smaller or more controlled through taxing them or requiring massive amounts of capital requirements. Wouldn't that funding move overseas anyway, and therefore wouldn't that create the negative externalities that you were talking about before?
Well, I understand your concern. My view on this is we have to focus on what we can control. In an ideal world, we would issue regulations and everybody around the world would share the same regulations and there'd be perfect harmony. But we have to focus on what we can control. And we can control the regulatory environment in the United States. And I think we should at least start there. Let's make the changes that we need to make in the U.S. to make the U.S. financial system sound. Let's have one set of rules. So if foreign global banks want to do business here, they got to follow our rules if they want to do business here. And by the way, I expect small and mid-sized banks in the U.S. to grow and fill some of the voids that may be created. Now, the other thing is, whatever we end up doing, if we go further, we do have to implement it gradually over time. And as we implement it gradually, I expect to see the banking sector and the economy evolve and adjust to fill whatever gaps may be created.
Mark?
Hi, thanks. Question for Neil. I'm Mark Spindell. You and the chairman talked about the possible interaction and interference of monetary policy and macroprudential management. Just hoping you can discuss your views about ways in which the most recent innovation, negative interest rates, helps or hinders your ability to regulate financial institutions.
Well, you know, I think that I'll refer back to Chair Yellen's testimony last week that just on negative interest rates, it's something that I think the Board of Governors and the FOMC feels like they have the authority to use if necessary, but our current outlook is not that we would have to use them. Our current outlook is for moderate economic growth and a gradually increasing interest rates with inflation going back up over the medium term to our target, and I'll probably leave it at that.
And I don't think it necessarily affects the ability to regulate. So interestingly, the Federal Reserve Board is stressing the banks against negative Treasury bill rates anyhow, right?
I mean, they're asking them
in the most recent stress test, the one that I guess they'll be doing this year, they're asking the banks to tell them what their how their capital would be affected if interest rates went into negative territory.
Sure, part of the sell-off that we've seen, for example, directly in the wake of the I'm not sort of asking the economic sort of position right to address clearly putting negative interest, imposing negative interest rates, whatever degree on their ability to operate as lenders, and I'm just curious from a regulatory perspective, helps, hinders.
Well, I guess I would say I think these are things that are looked at very carefully, and those are factors that will be considered as the committee moves forward. Bruce?
Yeah. Neil, you used the term transformational change because of the risk that you believe remains. Then you list first in that list breaking up the big banks, and then you go on to list some others as potential transformational change. As soon as you, my thought is that as soon as you mention breaking up the big banks, nobody hears anything else and writes off the whole idea, and that therefore some of the other ideas that have been mentioned, that you mentioned, and that have been mentioned by your co-panelists, like corporate governance change and your mention of taxing higher leverage, higher, et cetera, regulatory consolidation, these are transformational in their own ways, and they do not conjure up the ghost of trust busting.
Well, I appreciate your comment, and I think there's a lot of wisdom in what you said. And that's why I want to emphasize that we're not announcing a solution. We're announcing a process to bring together experts. You know, there are a lot of bold transformational ideas that are already out there from experts across the country. In my view, we haven't given them yet the consideration that they deserve. And what I'm trying to do is bring us together to create a process to give those different options serious consideration, and then we can hopefully together figure out what the best combination may be.
Okay, the patient man in the orange shirt.
Ken Meyercord, World Docs. I wonder if the panel agrees that capitalism is dependent on economic growth for its suitability as the basis for an economic system. And therefore, if we're in for a prolonged period of economic stagnation with the cost of capital at zero or even entering into negative territory, might not capitalism be replaced by some system that isn't dependent on usury?
Okay, and the gentleman in front of you.
Hans-Roger VB, most of the quantitative models which are used by central banks to guide them in macro stability decisions assume two things. One is risk premium are time varying, and then the second one is that risk is endogenous. As a result, monetary policy can mitigate those risks. The question is, in the assumption that the risks are actually exogenous, does monetary policy have a role? And if not, what is the alternative?
All right, so try me again. What risks are you talking about?
So the risk premium, which is time varying, and then the risk which is assumed to be endogenous. So in other words, it's created by the bank's own activities. But in the event that the risk is actually exogenous, it comes from other parts of the economy, does monetary policy have a role in mitigating those risks?
So is it true that when you think of policy and models, you think of the risk premium as being endogenous? rather than exogenous?
Both. So I think it certainly the risk premium depends on the risk appetite, and that might be exogenous or affected by things outside of monetary policy, like global political, geopolitical risks. At the same time, I think the monetary authorities recognize that what they do and how they're perceived to be operating and what the future brings and whether they can convince people it's a good future, bad future, does have an endogenous effect on risk premiums. So I'm not sure what.
Neil, do you think what we're talking about here is the end of capitalism, that the banking system has gotten to the point where we can't accept a market economy with banks that are privately owned?
Not at all. I mean, clearly the market economy is still going to be the key to our future, the key to economic growth, increasing prosperity. We just need to have a market economy where we can have that prosperity, that innovation, and we take off some of the risks of collapse off of the table.
Okay, Twitter.
Thank you. Pretty briefly, why now and why you in terms of your sort of leading on this issue?
Sure. Well, you know, why now and why me? I just started at the Minneapolis Fed, so I'm moving as fast as I can for that. And why me? I feel like what I bring to this is a unique perspective, like Don, like Chairman Bernanke, as being one of the few people who was on the front line responding to the financial crisis. And that really colors my thinking and my views as I look at the various reforms that have been implemented. And add to that, the Minneapolis Fed does have a lot of expertise in large banks and moral hazard. And I think bringing these things together to say, hey, I think we can do more, let's go do more. And the last thing I'll say, I'm repeating myself, is that there are a lot of experts around the country who have strong ideas about this. We don't presuppose that we have all the answers. We're trying to create a process to bring those experts together and say, let's together find a better solution.
Martin?
So welcome back to Brookings. It's great to see you. I was a little concerned that you are not more enthusiastic about the single point of entry approach and that way of dealing with large institutions. It seems like if you have enough TLAC, enough total loss absorbing capacity, so that it would be very hard for any bank to run through it, you're going to basically say that taxpayers are not going to support big banks. Using the single point of entry, you're able to resolve them either through Title I or through Title II in a way that does not disrupt the system. And by creating a bridge bank, you can allow foreign subsidiaries to operate. So why haven't we solved the problem? I mean, why are you wanting to do things that might gum up the gears more? Why not recognize this innovation for what it is?
Well, my concern is that if it really is, let's just take the TLAC, if it really is that credible and it's really not going to trigger contagion, then it'll probably be priced like equity. So why are we goofing around? Why don't we just raise the equity requirements of the banks instead of adding all this complexity and all this interaction? I mean, there's tremendous complexity in all the regulations. No, but I'll give you an example. So if I'm remembering correctly, I'm having to stretch my mind here. Think about Fannie and Freddie in 08. First of all, Fannie and Freddie were technically never supposed to be the responsibilities of the U.S. government, yet we had to step in and put the taxpayers behind Fannie and Freddie. Fannie and Freddie, hang on. Fannie and Freddie also had subordinated debt that was there available to recapitalize the firms, and we ended up protecting the subordinated debt, right? So in theory, that subordinated debt was TLAC. It was there specifically to provide protection for the senior creditors, and yet they ended up being protected in the midst of a crisis.
Right, but wait a minute. So there's two different points here. One is, and I think they're different. One is, you're saying that basically we can't take the government at its word, that in a crisis they will never allow the bondholders to take the hit that they've been warned against, right?
That's probably saying it a little stronger than I would say it, but yes.
Okay. That's a separate question from, and what's the answer? Why ask the banks to issue bonds that could become capital? What's the advantage of that over just having them hold more equity? Is it cheaper or?
Yeah, I think it's diversified. It's a little, it appeals to different investors. It's probably a little less expensive than equity, something that will pay interest until it converts to equity. I think these are new types of instruments, particularly those convertible bonds that we were talking about earlier. In the U.S., they're not issuing those. They're issuing I guess they're issuing more equity but more preferred shares and other subordinated debt at the holding company thing. So yeah, I do think it's not, you know, there are different investors, different characteristics. I assume there would be a different cost.
But again, I know I mentioned this earlier, but go back to the SIVs. There was no legal requirement for the banks to bail out the SIVs.
I don't see the.
But there was a
I don't see the analogy.
No,
here.
There was a reputational requirement, yeah. And so in the midst of a crisis, all of a sudden, if you would analyze the balance sheets of these banks, they looked healthier until all of a sudden the management said, "Oh my gosh, we have a reputational requirement to stand behind."
You think the banks will have a concern about their reputation if they convert the bonds?
No, I guess there's that. But I'm just saying, the lesson for me from that is that these very clear legal frameworks that look very clear today are not so clear in the time of a crisis.
Gary?
Are you going to go to, this may be way, are you going to go to prompt mark-to-market accounting? Because it seems to me that's critical. That's critical here. Otherwise, you know, the regulators can, the losses get, recognition of the losses get delayed and until you find out, indeed, there is, it is swamping capital. Now, I know a lot of people in financial services, as soon as you say mark-to-market accounting, you know, that's like, you know, there's a rat running around the room here. But, but you know, it takes a model to beat a model. So if you don't like that, what's better?
So I think the regulators have been pushing the accountants to allow the banks to recognize losses in a more forward-looking way than they have in the past. I think the mark-to-market accounting is very useful, but it's a little tricky on the liability side of the balance sheet. And can give, so when these bonds sell off, the banks have more equity? Not really. So it's a tricky issue. But
yeah.
I think recognizing the value of the assets and the impairments to the loans is absolutely critical for the health of the system and the market discipline.
Right. Okay, let's take a couple. There's one here. And the gentleman in the front, and then we'll call it a day.
Thank you. I'm Emily Leiner. I'm a policy advisor with Third Way, and I wanted to go back to Mr. Kashkari's announcement of the Minneapolis Fed initiative for ending Too Big to Fail. You acknowledge that it will eventually require congressional action to do anything to end Too Big to Fail, and that's probably the biggest obstacle, given that a lot of members of Congress don't agree with your initial premise that Dodd-Frank didn't go far enough. So how would your initiative address this impasse in a way that we haven't been able to in the last 6 years?
Okay, and gentlemen here.
Thank you so much, Stefan from the Woodrow Wilson Center. We are facing a very feeble global economy right now, so I was just wondering if you guys think it's possible that the next global financial crisis or global downturn will be triggered not from here, but from any foreign market. Thank you very much.
Okay, two good questions. So, Neil, you going to fix Congress too while you're at it?
That's it? Look, we have to do what we can, and we have responsibility to educate the public. That's why we're, by the way, we could go disappear into a closet and come out in 9 months and come up with our answer. The reason we're having a public process with live streaming the symposiums, bringing the experts in, having the press there, is to also educate the public along with us. And hopefully we can get members of Congress on both sides of the aisle to pay attention and to participate and take this seriously. So I take your point. We have to do whatever we can to try to get there.
Okay. Anybody want to, what are the odds that the next global financial crisis has its origins not in Northern California, but somewhere else, outside the United States?
I think they're pretty high. But I also think, and certainly a lot of the weakness that people are worried about today is less in the US and more overseas. But I also think it's important to note that there's a lot of international cooperation to strengthen banking systems everywhere through the Financial Stability Board, and to agree on resolution regimes, to agree on higher capital through Basel and the FSB, to agree on a framework that will make the system much safer and more resilient to shocks wherever they come from. Everybody is very, very aware that they could come from anywhere, and Neil's point is absolutely true. Whatever triggers something bad coming down, we probably don't see it and won't see it until it's right on top of us.
You know, earlier, somebody mentioned, by the way, oil prices. Should we have seen that? I mean, again, it's not the same thing as the housing bubble, but I don't know anybody who said, oh, there's an oil bubble and we need to take action to protect various sectors of the economy. And so things happen. There are exogenous shocks, and we need to be humble about how well we can predict them.
I don't think we'll identify the source of the next crisis before it happens. I think that's highly unlikely. I think the best thing we can do is try to be as prepared for it from whatever its source as possible, and which to me means getting the straightening out the incentives in the financial services industry first and foremost.
Do you think we're better off than we were the day before this all started in 2007?
Yes, I think we're clearly better off. We're maybe on second or third base. We know where home plate is, or at least I think I know where home plate is. I won't speak for others. We got to get there.
Okay, with that, please join me in thanking our panelists.